All right. I'm really excited to be joined by Steve. And actually, not a lot of people may know. I don't know if you remember this, but one of the reasons we started Founder Spring was based upon a conversation that we had, which was putting founders together and really building those dense networks so that founders can have that community the same way, you know, we've seen community sort of in Silicon Valley and California and others, and being able to have that be another tool that founders have, you know, even in terms of helping each other. So really excited to be able to have you be our a guest for this afternoon's Fireside.
No, I mean, I'm excited to be here, and I think that what you just brought up is like one of the reasons that Silicon Valley and Taiwan is very different, right? Is that I still remember going out to when I first moved out to Silicon Valley from Chicago, and at the Starbucks where you're waiting in line, and the people in front of you and the people behind you, they're all entrepreneurs and they're all talking about tech. And it was just last week. It was like the first time where I think I was taking my kid to like a jiu-jitsu class, and I was so happy to meet somebody from Taida that actually was a computer science major that I didn't know before, because I thought I already knew all the entrepreneurs in Taipei. And so, I mean, I think like it's events like this, and I think more events like this that's going to be able to bring up that culture of getting startup and founders and entrepreneurs together, because it's harder to kind of meet these people in the Starbucks line when it's a Starbucks in Taipei.
Well, so let's rewind, right? Because everyone knows the tremendous legacy that you've built at YouTube, PayPal, but you were born in Taiwan, is that right? Can you talk us through how you, you know, going from Taiwan into the US and how you got started in tech?
Yeah, I don't remember much from those that period in Taiwan, right? I mean, it was, I remember the multiplication table was learned here, but it was second grade when I left and moved to Chicago, and that's where I spent elementary school, junior high. Went to a boarding school out there that was kind of focused on math and science, and that's kind of what planted the seeds for. It was sort of mid-90s around that period, so first planted the seeds about kind of the internet, being able to kind of see what was possible with the internet. Ended up going to school also in Champaign-Urbana, and then that's where I met, Mark Andreessen had just left, but that's where I met the PayPal group, and that was with Max Lev, Chen, and a couple of the people that started PayPal were also the same kids that went to the same high school I did in Illinois. And so it was directly in 1999, moving from Chicago to Palo Alto, Silicon Valley area to join that PayPal group. And it was 20 years, and we can get into that, but it was 20 years spent in Silicon Valley. And then in 2019, right before COVID actually started, so before we knew what was going to be happening in 2020, we had moved back to Asia. And it was just because we were doing some, completely random, we were just doing some remodeling. We thought it was going to be a 1 year trip. I wanted my kids who were born and grew up kind of in San Francisco Bay Area to experience Asia by themselves. I thought it was important for them as part of their culture, as part of growing up, to actually be here on the ground. But, you know, we're fast forward with everything that's happened in the last few years. Like, we're still here, and we're looking at whatever high school is in Taiwan, and we're really extending the stay here. And as part of that, too, is really doing more and more of bringing that Silicon Valley experience and trying to do some of that locally, and part of that process is just evaluating the kind of the key differences between the two areas.
Well, you've definitely had a big impact because you're part of that pre-COVID wave of folks moving from California to Taiwan, and you're one of the reasons I was able to get my citizenship back by setting up the whole gold card program. So, and you're gold card number one. What made you want to, you know, do government work?
And so in Taiwan, especially Taiwan, I think they've seen that there were so many successful Taiwanese Americans in Silicon Valley, disproportionate amount. And even now with NVIDIA, with AMD, and you're looking around at like a lot of these CEO companies and public companies, private companies. And I think in Taiwan, they're scratching their heads as to what was so special about that flight across the Pacific that makes these companies successful, whereas they look locally, and it's been difficult to find there's been successful companies, but not on that kind of global scale that you've seen in Silicon Valley, right? And I think that the Gold Card program was trying to bring people with that kind of experience, not just within tech and entrepreneurship, but all abroad to find a reason to be able to come to Taiwan. And Taiwan is a great place to really, we moved our entire family back. It's a great place for the family. It's a safe place for the family. It's a great place for the kids to grow up. But I think that I do sense that a key missing element has been on kind of on the entrepreneur, on the startup side, to be able to really do something here is more challenging than in Silicon Valley. But you know, but I, during these last few years, I've seen like Singapore, Hong Kong's created a program, and even a lot of areas in Southeast Asia have been inviting more and more of the entrepreneurs to be able to not just start something there, but really to move there, to really grow out their teams locally in those areas.
Yeah, so let's get into your entrepreneurial journey, because I'm sure with all the founders that we have here, that's really something that where there's a lot of interest in, and a lot of learnings there. So you'd mentioned you met Max at Champaign Urbana. You ended up working at PayPal, and that has just been an incredible source of founder energy, and just, you know, they talk about the PayPal mafia. What was going on at PayPal? Like, what happened where, you know, you have companies like SpaceX, LinkedIn, Yelp, YouTube, like, you know, what contributed to so much founder energy that when people left PayPal, they just started these incredible companies?
I mean, I do think a lot of it happens to be kind of just luck and timing, right? PayPal was one of the few companies that started right before that dot-com crash in 1999. And so it had just closed a funding round, and Sequoia was part of that. And then as soon as the dot-com crash happened, I think all the companies in Silicon Valley had to find a way to survive, knowing that that next round of funding was going to get indefinitely delayed. And I remember at PayPal at the time, it was supposed to be, I mean, I think many startups, it was just about growth, and the metrics were just about scalability. It wasn't about monetization. But as soon as you found out that that pending subsequent funding round was not going to happen anytime soon, you really have to readjust what you're looking for and reprioritize. And one of the things early on at PayPal was to be able to create a revenue model, and that was with generating fees for businesses to receive funds. And so personal use on PayPal continued to be free, but if you are a business account, still, like if you are receiving over a certain amount of cash, and especially the big area where PayPal was most popular was on eBay, and there was, you know, down the line there was an actual eventual acquisition of eBay with PayPal. But if you were an eBay seller, that's where the monetization was coming from, right? And I think that that was an interesting period of just going through that dot-com crash, and one of the few companies that actually was able to make it out of there, and eventually go IPO, go through an acquisition, go through kind of the same things with eBay, where eBay was taking the PayPal would put on like a pay now button, eBay would take it off, and then it was always kind of going to the actual end users to say, do you want to support PayPal? And this is the same, almost a repeat story when we were doing YouTube, and it wasn't Facebook at the time, but there was this another service that I don't know if it's still around, MySpace at the time in 2005.
Ouch.
But it was all the same thing, because it was PayPal was a service for eBay, and YouTube was a service for people that needed to share more than just photos and messages. They wanted to share videos, and you know, even with that service in place, you had to find some user base for it, and it turned out to be MySpace. But there were all sorts of things where MySpace, as soon as they saw that YouTube was taken over, they were taking down the videos, and it was almost replaying the same things. But I think that 2005 period was kind of that Web 2.0 phase that was coming out, and a lot of the folks that were coming out of PayPal, I mean, a large part of the engineering team that we hired at YouTube were all from PayPal. People were just thinking about after PayPal, after the acquisition by eBay, what do we do next? It's a little bit too early to just call it just retire. So I think during that period, it was all these people with 4 or 5 years of experience all leaving at the same time and all kind of supporting each other. And so I think, like, if you were to look back at all those companies, it was all within that sort of 6 months period that they all started.
Now, obviously, YouTube is one of the most powerful platforms in technology today. And not a lot of companies are born into that. And I'm sure you had to go through your own, you know, iterations of what YouTube would look like. It might seem obvious with hindsight, but can you talk us through that journey and that process of you know, trying to find product market fit with YouTube early days?
Sure. And there's two versions of that too, right? I think there's the PR version and then there's what's really happened.
Let's fast forward to the what really happened.
Because YouTube now is way bigger than what we originally thought. We just thought we should just build a, and at the time it was a specific narrower service. It wasn't just general platform for all videos. So we thought, like, maybe we could take a dating service at the time and just create a video version of that. So this is going back again to 2005, and there was a service at the time called hotornot.com where you would upload your photos and people would rate if that photo was hot or not. And we just thought the world needed a video version of the service.
You're kidding me. So YouTube's first iteration was the video version of James Hong's Hot or Not?
Yeah, but after a week, there were no uploads. So we said, well, before we quit, like, let's just generalize it. Let's change the hearts into stars. Let's just make it less about hot or not and just make it into, because all the backend was the same, all the transcoding, the videos, that was all new, right? People, you didn't have to download any apps, you didn't have to install anything, it automatically worked on the Mac, on Linux, on Windows. You can play the videos inside the browser, you can embed the videos on any other service out there, real-time transcoding, so as soon as you uploaded it, that was all working. It was just trying to figure out what audience is gonna use this. This is before, years before the iPhone, it was still a little challenging to create these videos. So it was trying to figure out where's that product fit. And it eventually ended up being MySpace. It was, and I bring that up, it's like PayPal at the same time. After all that payment service was built, they still needed to find a place to be able to see transactions happen. And so it was the video version of Hot or Not for a week. We saw no uploads, and so we just thought, before we give up, what's another use for all this technology? And at that time, we just said, let's completely open it up for all sorts of videos. And that's when the video started, at first trickling in, but then as more and more people started finding out about it. And there were a few videos, I think, from like Saturday Night Live, like Nike uploaded a video that reached 1 million views in 2005. And it's that viral growth where people also start to see, like, oh, I can also hit this upload button, and it's also something that I can use to become not just a viewer, but also a creator.
But your video of your cat, was that in the hot or not phase or the post-hot or not phase?
That was early on, yeah.
That was just a test video, right?
Well, I was invited out by, like, this cat society in London, and they said, we're not inviting you out because you're a co-founder of YouTube, but you have the first cat video on YouTube, and we want you to speak at an event. It's like a 30-second video of, like, my cat pajamas at the time. But it was still so early of just trying to figure out, like, where this is. I want to say this is well before monetization, right? And so, like, you don't have the creator network in that ecosystem in place that you have now. And we're still trying to figure out, so what kind of videos are people going to be willing to share? Or are people even going to be willing to share videos publicly? The thought was a lot of people have photos and videos that would share privately within their families and friends or their networks. But would they be uploading videos with zero views, with no intentions of knowing who's going to be watching this video, and then just giving it to the world? So that concept was something that was being tested as we rolled out YouTube.
That's extremely fascinating, because one of the most powerful consumer platforms of the world, you still had to really iterate on trying to find that product market fit.
Yeah, and a large part of it, I think, is really on the monetization side eventually, mm-hmm. right? And I mean, you know, like fast forward a few years and there was the acquisition by Google, but they really, really, really helped get over the hurdles on the legal side of things. So the big thing at the time was a lot of people, they didn't know that they weren't allowed to, they didn't have the permissions even. Even if you go out and buy a CD, you don't have the permissions to reuse that music in any way other than for personal purposes. So people would be putting in, just to put some sound effects in the end of their, or throughout the videos, they would be actually encoding audio as part of that. And you have technologies even back then, like Audible Magic was one where within a few seconds they would detect audio signature and then be able to figure out who owns the distribution rights for this and who's gonna, and a lot of it was the Universal, EMI, Sony BMG at the time in the US. But they were also trying to figure out what is going to happen beyond CDs, like as people started moving towards downloading content, buying content online, streaming with the iPod, what was going to be next, right? But generally their first step is litigation, and so that was the lawsuit that was coming in. And in fact, there was like a big lawsuit coming in from Universal at the time, and then even on there was another $1 billion lawsuit that ended up getting resolved after the acquisition by Viacom because of content that was coming in from Comedy Central. But I think all these players, they were just trying to figure out how are they gonna integrate their content, these content creators, onto YouTube. And if you were to equate YouTube as, how are they gonna make that march onto the internet when all their distributions traditionally has been off the internet? And that's just in the US, right? I mean, there was like all this anime content that was happening. At the time of the acquisition, it was about 50% of the viewers and the content was in the US, 50% of it was already outside the US. And so at the time, you could point to this Digital Millennium Copyrights Act to say that we're a US company, so go through this for takedown content. But we knew as soon as the content views and content created was happening outside the US, over 50%, we had to do something there. And so that was really like looking at all the anime content and just every country that Chad, the other co-founder, and I visited. We were not well liked because every one of these countries was dealing with the same issues of how are we going to get our content online yet still be able to have control, copyrights, and monetization over this content.
Yeah, it's a fascinating insight into what was happening almost 20 years ago that's being played out again and again, where the the first response of rights holders tends to be litigation. But in the end of the, just fast forward, the technology platform actually helps with distribution, helps, things go viral. Now they all have official channels. It becomes an important part of their monetization strategy. Yeah. But of course, at the time, you were facing a $1 billion lawsuit by Viacom, Universal, others. How much of that went into the decision to get acquired by a company with deeper pockets?
No, 100%. No, I mean, I think that there were two big challenges, I think, in the pre-acquisition. One of them was just the bandwidth cost, right? Just for every, it's 2005, 2006. This, does that work? This was still a period before AWS launched, before anything with Google Cloud was out there, before Microsoft and all the data centers launched. So that was still a period where you had to be there when the trucks were, you had to order your machines, 6 to 8 weeks in advance. You had to be there when the trucks were offloading your 42U racks in, whether it's in San Jose, whether it's in LA, whether it's in New Jersey. You had to be in the parking lot. You had to be the ones that pushed this up to the third floor, plug in all the Ethernet cables. And so, and that's that, but I think on the power side, but more importantly on the bandwidth side, we were using over 10% of the internet's traffic at that point. And we're all about a kind of a net neutrality, and that all data should be the same, and so you shouldn't charge YouTube anymore. But that was just because we didn't want to really pay any more content. I mean, I couldn't care less about network neutrality. And we were talking a lot at the time with Netflix, because we were, between Netflix and YouTube, all that streaming content was being, all that streaming bandwidth was being used by us. And so And it continued to grow up more and more in price as we started getting more popular. Luckily, after a certain amount of traffic, you start doing, there's these conferences between other big networks, and you start doing these peer-to-peer agreements, and so you no longer have to go across the sort of open internet. You get to be able to connect directly with you can connect with all the Canadian users directly in a data center in New York, and so all of a sudden, all the viewers from Canada, you can actually directly distribute. So I think from our standpoint, we were able to figure out the scalability, and over a period of time, just bandwidth started getting cheaper and cheaper. But on the litigation side, we had one lawyer, and there was no way that we were going to be able to kind of defend YouTube for what it was doing, and we really needed the help from somebody else. And so that was the main driver for the march forward with the acquisition. And I mean, that whole process it was a total of 6 days. We talked to Yahoo at the time, we talked to Google at the time. It couldn't be known that we were talking to them because Universal, if they knew, they were gonna be, this is getting into the specifics, but they were going to take 5% of the company. And so we did it at a Denny's restaurant for breakfast. And you're meeting with like the Eric Schmidt and Larry Page, like the co-founders of Google. You're meeting with Jerry Yang, the co-founders of Yahoo, over a Denny's breakfast to talk about like a $1.5 billion acquisition.
The Yahoo deal was also...
Well, that was a kind of an inside joke. Yeah, we had the first meeting with Yahoo, and we didn't want it to be on the Yahoo campus because we would be detected, and we didn't know where it was going to go. We didn't want to do it in YouTube office, so we said, where's a place that they're never going to recognize? So we said, Denny's? Denny's breakfast? And who's going to pay for the meal? Like, are we good? Is Jerry going to pay for this, or am I going to be buying breakfast for Jerry? And then when we met with David Drummond, who was the chief legal officer, and Larry at the time, they were asking where to meet, and we knew that it wasn't going to be on their campus, and it wasn't going to be, we thought an inside joke would, wouldn't it be funny if we met with them on the same table that we met with Yahoo a few days ago? But we ended up having 3 meetings all at that Denny's, and then all of Saturday, Sunday, we were going through all of the Wilson Sassini and Page Melrose to go through all the paperwork, and then on Monday evening, right after the market closed, we ended up making the announcement publicly that Google was going to move forward with the acquisition.
I remember that. I was at Google at the time, and it was $1.65 billion, which was eye-popping at the time. And it was just an incredible, I mean, just to give you a sense of the scale, it was like, you know, MySpace went for $500 million.
Yeah.
And that was largely seen as the sort of the top end of, you know, social at the time. And then so the $1.65 billion, obviously something that just went through the ecosystem as a, oh my gosh, how could this ever be? But in hindsight, are there any regrets, or what would you do differently if you had the opportunity today?
Well, it's gotten a little bigger since that acquisition, YouTube. Since I think 2020 and 2021, Google started splitting out the numbers. Before that, they were counting all the revenue the same. And it's a big fraction of what the overall revenue is. I mean, it's the second largest search engine that's used after Google. It's actually the most popular streaming music platform, except most people don't consider YouTube to be a music platform, so they put other ones up there. But it's a very popular service, it's a very popular site. But I have to say, at that time when that acquisition happened, I really don't think that YouTube would have made it past another couple years without Google there. And Google was very supportive, right? I mean, Eric Schmidt, the CEO at the time, Sunday before the announcement on Monday about the acquisition, he came in and he didn't need to be there. It was just at that point, it was just all legal work to actually pass that through. But he took Chad and me aside and just said, we put all of our resources and all of our talent into Google Video, a competitor of YouTube at the time. And for whatever reason, your group of 58 people behind YouTube were able to, with your you know, funding from Sequoia, you guys were able to continue to out-compete and outdo what Google Video was doing. So we want to keep things separate. Separate as in like your offices are going to be separate. You guys get to decide. And you guys are, I think the key thing was you guys are going to be in the controlling pilot seats for YouTube moving forward. And as long as you can deliver on these metrics, and the metrics were, they made sense for both sides, which is like the number of views per day, the number of uploads per day, number of new creators a day. As long as you can keep these metrics growing at the same pace that we've seen in the documents prior to the acquisition, we're gonna keep you guys in the controlling seats. And that was something that, you know we didn't get at PayPal, and that's why so many of the folks left PayPal after eBay. And that was something that took a lot of guts, I think, from Google to let a couple 20-year-olds run this thing. And it's like you get to prioritize when you want to work with Google Search, when you want to work with Google Maps, how you want to integrate, when do you want to localize. And so all the people that were part of that acquisition, they ended up, and it helped that the day after that was announced on Tuesday, they started sending over all the Google food that was being cut. They started sending that over to the San Bruno office. And so I think any of the engineers that were in doubt, as soon as they saw the free food coming from Google, they're like, okay, this is a good choice.
Integration, post-acquisition integration tip, just send food. So I want to open it up to some questions, but maybe exploring now to current day, you've done a tremendous amount of for the Taiwan startup ecosystem, as mentioned earlier. You've also built teams now both in Silicon Valley as well as Taiwan. One of the few people that have experience of both sides of the Pacific. Can you comment on or compare on those different experiences in building teams in Silicon Valley versus Taipei?
Yeah, I think there are clear differences, right? I mean, I think in Silicon Valley, the one thing that's been always difficult has been trying to get just good engineers. There's so much competition, there's so much funding, there's so many startups out there that from an engineering standpoint, you have the luxury of choosing where you want to work. And if you're not happy with it, there are plenty of other choices. And in Taiwan, I think it was rather rare to find serial entrepreneurs that have had past successes come in and want to start something that they've got funding already for, and they're ready to give out stock compensation packages similar to what you get in Silicon Valley. And so that was one thing I think from the engineering side, but I do think after 20 years in Silicon Valley, you do lose sight a little bit of what Silicon Valley also has to offer. You kind of take it for granted, but the convenience of just meeting meeting so many other co-founders and people with similar minds and ideas, the risk tolerance for everybody across the from the founders onto the engineers, from the designers, like they're from product managers, business, they're all willing to try something new that may have not been done before. But I do think that the reason why I'm still here in Taiwan is that I do think that it's possible to integrate some of those missing elements into Taiwan and together with what is available here to be able to create sort of a Silicon Valley within Asia here.
I'm going to open it up. If you have a question.
While she's getting the mic, any advice that you have for these founders that are building companies here and building a global brand or trying to reach global markets?
I think that's a great question, right? Because I think we've been kind of dancing around with a few formulas, and we haven't seen the sort of the guaranteed success yet, but I think what's been working pretty well, and it's actually a bit of a, not a completely novel idea, because it's a little bit borrowing from what has worked from Israel and Singapore and some of these countries that have done pretty well when it comes to whatever creating unicorns from. There is like they do send a team, usually the founding team or the at least a couple people, maybe the CFO and the product person into Silicon Valley, and they end up having them physically locate there. being closer to whether it's content partnerships, whether it's the investors, and then they would have nightly calls with their teams in their respective country, right? It pains me a little to say, like, I think a stepping stone for Taiwan would be actually to send some of their founders outside of Taiwan. You still have a team here, that's great, but I think that it's important to be more closely tied and connected with the broader network, and the only way I think to do that is really to have a physical presence in those countries.
Spend time in those markets.
Hi, my name is Thomas. I invested in several startups myself. I also run some companies in Taiwan. And I'm a long-time YouTube user as well, and I think you touch a lot of subjects like the copyright and net neutrality, right, with streaming services, and also the technology, which I think even nowadays is important for Google, the YouTube technology, because if I playback a video on Google Drive, there's actually a YouTube URL inside the link, right? And so I think they use the transcoding and whatever. And but my question is more about the sales side, because this morning we spent the whole time talking about B2B sales. And one of those guys who called in from San Francisco, he said, like, okay, hey, you know, you need to keep your five customers like the besties whatsoever. And I never really understood 17 years ago when Google bought YouTube, which is a long, long time ago now. And now it's, I think, 11% of the 280 billion revenue of Google is from YouTube still. My question is, like, who did you consider were your customers back then? And I think mostly advertisers probably. But how did you manage to keep those advertisers on board to come to you? And did you really consider them like your besties, or did you always keep them close and charge them a lot? Or like how did you work with on the B2B selling side to cater to those advertisers as a platform?
No, that's a good question, right? Because we spent about 2 years after the acquisition trying to discuss that issue. And so even after the acquisition for 2 years, monetization was being discussed, but it wasn't implemented. The CPM rates on videos is far higher than CPM rates on general Google searches, text searches. But instead of just putting in, if you put a 30-second pre-roll, you're getting, or interstitials, post-rolls, you're getting a lot of money from advertisers to be able to get eyes on those videos. But I think we were looking at Google as kind of the example of, like, they have what the ads, you have the users, and you have the actual the websites itself. And it was trying to make we were trying to equate that on the YouTube side. You have the content creators, you have the viewers, and you have the advertisers. And how do you create an ecosystem that all three parties are happy with? And it's difficult. Usually people, all people, that I don't think they're really fond of having to watch like a 15-second pre-roll in front of the ads that they have to watch, or they have to get into some kind of subscription plan, right? And so it was talking with, and I have to say, like, Google was pretty good in terms of not rushing it out. They could have, if they wanted to, just monetize, and then quarterly results would show that the acquisition was a good one. But I think they were respecting that if we do this too early, this is a long-term investment and we're going to lose the users. And so putting in the actual model of, well, the biggest one was just first working with the Warners and EMI and figuring out how are we going to be able to work with the copyrights. But after that phase was putting in the what is in place now, which is the revenue sharing, and being able to make the, every time that you're, I guess every time you're watching a video, one, you know the content creator is making some money off of it, but I think that somehow, as the viewer, you're also aware that when you're watching this ad, that it also benefits the person that's now probably like full-time working on creating this content. And so in some way, to be able to do that revenue sharing makes it a little more, I don't know, sympathetic to watching the pre-roll, to know that this is how, and usually it's like now it's not just individual creators, but entire almost, you know, companies that are formed just to create this content. The entire 100% of their revenue model is coming from these ads, and so people are starting to kind of watch that. And I don't know that people that don't want to watch the ads, as they start doing the subscription services on YouTube, a part of that revenue also goes to the content that you're watching as well. But it's complicated. I mean, it's stuff like all the amount of AI machine learning that goes into just even like the related videos, and what kind of, like, there was a movie that just came out, YouTube Effects, that was talking about, like, is it just about monetization, about creating the best content for related, or is it about, you know, regardless of whether it's fake or true news. It's just about creating content. And it's I think there's a huge area in between that's a little ambiguous and vague about what kind of videos that you should be recommending after you're done with the videos, what kind of videos should be showing up on the related video side, because all of it, at the end of the day, is going to be going back into the monetization model.
Other questions?
Hey Steve, my name is George. Actually, I just want to ask if there was a backstory to the name YouTube and what other names you had considered before picking it. How did you guys pick it? How much did you pay for that domain name, et cetera?
Yeah, I think you can look up like the DNS information. That name was registered on a Valentine's Day in 2005, so that goes to show that who I was with on Valentine's Day in 2005. In Taiwan, a lot of time I hear it pronounced like YouTube or something, but the idea for YouTube was, tube is supposed to be kind of like this 1950s, 1960s, like name for a TV, and so it was supposed to be the combination of two words, you and you being the content creator, I guess, on the TV as well as the person that's watching the TV, so kind of combining that, those two words together to create YouTube as the platform to enable that.
Next question. Go ahead.
Hi Steve, just a follow up on something you said during the, when you were talking, is like, did you ever figure out what was it you were doing that Google Video was not doing that you guys were able to, Eric first asked you?
Yeah, this is being recorded too, right? all right, I'll be honest. I think that, look, as a company that's received like $11.5 million of funding that's not publicly traded, you can push the envelope a lot further on what you permit and not permit without feeling like you're gonna be getting any challenging remarks from your shareholders. You only have a couple shareholders. So I think we were able to really push the boundaries on how we wanted to deal with copyrighted content. And so for like one great example is like we knew Google had the ability to do the real-time transcoding that we were offering, but they couldn't do it because they had to go through a process. I think it was a couple days, in fact, of after uploading the video, we're going to review the content, and then we're going to say whether or not we're going to be able to permit this to be viewed on Google. Whereas, you know, YouTube, anything you want to upload, you can upload it within a few seconds. You can share this content. But there are so many of those things where, like, I think Google was also depends on what kind of content you can actually embed on other sites as well. And so some of it had to be on viewed on Google, but some of it you could actually view on. And YouTube was just completely open on everything that you could do on it.
And we see the same pattern now with LLMs, right? There's a reason why OpenAI was able to release ChatGPT and GPT-3, GPT-2 and 3.5 before Google even had an opportunity. Because of the sensitivities around, you know, allowing BERT or, you know, any other model to be out there to say things that a startup could say, but a larger incumbent would not be able to say. So, lots of questions. Go
ahead. Hey, Steve. I'm Chiwei. Thanks for sharing. I have a question about the initial funding for YouTube, and then. Did you have angel investment to pay for the network costs and all that? And does that help, or in which way, like, it formed the destiny for the company? Like, for example, did VC push you to sell quickly or something like that?
I mean, there are some specific tales about that. You can search online. Like, there was an early company that we were using called Server Beach at the time, and the way that they were trying to attract new users was they were just saying that any new user, you automatically could use 2,000 gigabytes of data transfers. But there was no way they could actually scale that out. It was just a kind of a marketing slogan that you can use 2000 until we came along. And every time we were tracking, like anytime we came to 1,999 gigabytes transferred, we would just buy a new machine. And so we get this call from Texas one day that says, like, we need to talk. Like, we don't, you're already using just our, all of the primary, but also all the backup bandwidth that we have in all of our data centers. So you can search on YouTube, like, they had to fly out to just talk to us about how we're gonna continue to scale it up. No, but I mean, I think that, yes, we did receive two funding rounds. And again, like, I think it was through the YouTube network that we automatically had Roloff, who was at Sequoia at the time. They did the Series A and the Series B funding round. Roloff was the CFO at PayPal. He helped the PayPal IPO go. And then after that same thing, around that 2005 period, when we left to go create YouTube, he started at Sequoia, and it was through that connection that we had the Sequoia investments. And a lot of that too, through Sequoia, was how we got the, how immediately when we made the decision to want to sell the company, we were able to have the two Denny's breakfasts with Yahoo and Google. And I would further add, like, that's the, like, those are the things that are, I'm gonna say, like, maybe not impossible, but much harder to do if you were based in Taiwan. Like, if you were to have created a, there was a site at the time called, and it still kind of exists today, Daily Motion, that was created in France, and it was doing pretty well. But I think one of the primary reasons that they couldn't do as well, they weren't as close to Sand Hill Road to be able to meet with Sequoia and Lightspeed and all the VCs that we talked to. They weren't that close to be able to have Denny's breakfast with Yahoo CEOs and Google. So there is something that's kind of like, it's a little bit difficult to be able to really capture, but those are the missing elements if you're not in Silicon Valley, to not be able to be that close to the venture capital, to be that close to strategic partners, and ultimately, if you're going to go to the acquisition route, the acquirers.
Other questions?
Yeah. Hello, Steve. My name is Chui, similar to his name. So my question is, YouTube started with the YouTube ads, and then there's a profit sharing model with the creators. But right now there's a lot of like paid sponsorship directly to the creators. So skipping the platform. So how does YouTube keep the balance or possibly benefit from this kind of act that creators are earning their own money but skipping the platform's profit?
I left in 2011, you know. So this is like a few generations beyond, I think, just even the monetization model adds rev share to this point. I know that there's, it's a pretty general and open network when it comes to experiments like that YouTube has with the like, for example, right now, I think all ads that you get on YouTube, they have to come through Google, but they're allowing, they were trying to experiment around with other advertisers, so you can choose who you want to work with. It doesn't have to be Google ads, but it could be from other ad creators as well. And so, I mean, I think that, yeah, I wouldn't be qualified to be able to answer that question. I mean, I would be able to guess, but it would just be as clear as you in terms of what internally they think about that. But I would say, like, in general, when I was there and when in Google's model, it does prioritize, I think, what is good for the content creators and what is good for the viewers. And I think it's often much easier to criticize than it is to criticize what you see on YouTube, like something that you don't like, maybe a video that's there or too many ads. But I think, like, put in the pilot seat, it's much harder than the follow-up question, like, well, what would you do instead? And that's the much harder question to answer.
I have a really hard question around if you were in the pilot seat. Because a lot of times, this is your baby, right? Now you've sold it to Google, and oftentimes you are seeing things done with it that maybe you may or may not agree with. I'm going to rewind a little bit to the sort of the 2020-2022 era, where YouTube was squarely in a situation where information from WHO, CDC, and others got priority over other forms of information about COVID, about what was spreading. And you got a sense of how important YouTube was to that whole system of getting information, real-time information, in a fast-moving context. And of course, they made some decisions there, you know, the best that they thought was. But what was it like watching that? Like, were there things that you felt like you would have done differently or would have taken a different direction?
I mean, I think that's the hard part is like, you know, if it's not completely AI driven or something, how do you actually decide what is the right content to be showing? And it's just like, or like, even when I was there, like there was about what kind, you can flag content on YouTube, and of course you can find the copyrighted content, and so you can take those down. But once it starts getting into like, once you start flagging the content for, say, violence, like, oh, there was like a 500 page paper that was distributed internally for all the people that were actually making those decisions about what defined violence. Like, what, like, when you get, because they, you're supposed to make all the same decisions, so whoever's been, whoever's working, and whoever's looking at that content that's been flagged, they have to be able to accept or reject that flag. And you know, like, what really is fake news? Like, you could say, like, CNN or New York Times is fake news by some people. I mean, I think, like, so, like, oftentimes it's what comes up on the search results on YouTube or on Google, is that really supposed to be the stuff that's on there? And that's a really, I mean, I want to say it's a contentious issue, and I don't think that YouTube's always right in making that, but same thing, and like, versus it's tough to make that decision about what is the priority and what about sort of, you know, what is like not sort of mainstream science or mainstream beliefs? Do you take that down, or can you bring, if there's a lot of views on that content, should it just naturally go up, or do you have to make the sort of subjective call about that's not real news or that's not real science, this is real science and we can't, you know? And I think it's a difficult one to make.
Hi, my name is Bill, and I'm curious about your point of view on future competition landscape of short videos. We know YouTube changed our entertainment from watching TV to choosing what we want to see, and people think that short video could be the next big thing, and it already is. So, yeah, just curious about, do you think like platform create this kind of form, like TikTok can take over the market and be the only one, or YouTube maybe you can beat them by making shorts or entertainment, or just curious about how, is it going to be a monopoly or like in the other way around?
No, it won't be a monopoly. I can't say that. I think YouTube Shorts was directly, you know, launched because of what TikTok's doing, right? And yeah, I think that it's like, I think it's unquestionable that like there's a huge audience and growing audience for the content creators as well as the content viewers for the short form content. I think it's, we'll see. I mean, specifically to TikTok, we're going to see what happens in the U.S. with that. Like states like Montana are looking at whether or not we should just ban TikTok from the state. But like removing from just talking about TikTok specifically in terms of short-form content, like even on YouTube, YouTube Shorts versus the original content that's on YouTube, they're viewed very differently in the ways that you interact with them, you view them, you whatever, share them, comment on them. I think there are two really different libraries of content. But you know, I'd be curious to see what happens. But I think YouTube, or not YouTube, but short form content is here to stay. But I think that they could coexist with the typical content that you find on YouTube in the original YouTube form?
Well, see, we are very grateful for the legacy you've left both with PayPal and YouTube because, you know, as you're mentioning, not only is it good for music and videos, but it's probably one of the most effective learning platforms. And so, you know, parents with kids know how much the actual MOOC is YouTube.com. And for all, I mean, we're all also very grateful for everything you've done with the Taiwan startup ecosystem. So please join me in thanking Steve for joining us today.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you very much.